Today, I would be talking about basically the interstellar medium, which in short and now we call as ISM, and the neutral hydrogen in the galaxy. And generally, I would start with ISM, then talk more about H1. And in general, there is no fundamental difference between ISM and H1 is because H1 is part of ISM. So they basically share many common characteristics, but not necessarily all the properties are the same. Because, for example, things which differ is the temperature between different components. So that is there. So, yeah, interstellar medium is basically what is defined as what is between stars in galaxy and galaxies. It's not just our galaxy which has ISM, but every the galaxy has some amount of ISM, either the low density, high density, the size, that will all differ. Now, the main thing is that the ISM, as compared to stars which we easily can see with telescopes, this ISM stays mostly invisible while observing the sky. But then the question comes, why then study ISM interstellar matter? It's because the stars are from the interstellar hydrogen. Then the next thing is the stellar outflows makes ISM richer. For example, when a star, especially the, I would say, massive stars, which are mass several times of sun, they do have wings. Even we know that our sun itself has solar wind. But leaving that aside, the large, bigger stars, the more massive stars, have significantly more massive, meaning large amount of wind they produce, and that can go even to meaning several astronomical units. And the largest stars, like the OB giant and so on, they can have influence. The influence means the stellar wind, which is carrying metals, which are produced because of stellar evolution. That means hydrogen going into helium, then helium going into carbon and nitrogen and such things, the one by one. They could essentially come out to stellar wind and enrich the about a parsec region, meaning several light years, around the stars in its lifetime. But this is not at the beginning, but at near before it goes into supernova for a massive star. Even then, the interstellar medium is already being enriched around the meaning from several AUs to almost a parsec for O and B star the types. Okay, the third is, of course, the most important is that the stellar end of life products gets dispersed and forms part of the ISM. That means that when the stars finally, especially the massive stars, end in supernova explosion, we know that most of the metals which we see in the universe has really come from the supernova explosions. For example, we, in that sense, if you look at, you would have already heard of in TV and Discovery Channel, whatever, that we are essentially created from the metals or the materials which are coming from supernova the explosions. So, because the more than iron, even not produced in any other way in the universe typically, the iron is very difficult to produce without having a supernova explosion. So that is why supernova explosion is important. Now, rather than going first into all these things, I would first go into the ISM is broadly divided into the gaseous medium, which is basically various types of gases, including hydrogen and helium and so on. And then you have dust. Also, you have high energy particles, that is the cosmic ray particles. And of course, the considered very seriously in the past, but now we know, meaning for the last many decades, last several decades, the magnetic field is also an integral part of the interstellar medium. And well, we know that magnetic field is everywhere, but then why bother? The reason we bother is that magnetic field also has, if you consider the magnetic field energy, that is effectively in CGS unit, we would call it as B square by 8 pi. This just unit conversion, effectively it's proportional to B square. That energy in the magnetic field, energy density, would be similar to what is the energy density in the general ISM. So in general interstellar medium, so it's comparable, I'm saying, within a factor of few. So that's why magnetic field can also influence how the interstellar medium, various gases flow and so on, especially the ionized gas. So it has significant influence on that, because you know that there are two issues how the magnetic field affects. That one is the particles which are charged particles. If they're flowing along the magnetic field, no problem. But if they go perpendicular, they will start rotating, they will have basically acceleration. So they will lose energy. So that is one thing which it influences. And the other thing is for example, because of interstellar medium is fairly conducting. So this conducting medium has certain issues on how it contracts and expands if you consider magnetic versus not consider magnetic. So those things are there, but rather than going into magnetic field, now let's go again into the discovery of ISM first, that how this was discovered. Because what is surprising is that, because from Galileo's time we know that, okay, stars are they are everywhere in the galaxy, but it is basically William Herschel who first described that there are holes in the sky, in the sense that there is apparent deficit of stars in certain parts of the sky as you look at. So this was an indication that there is something hidden there. But then, more the quantitatively, Hartmann was the one who found absorption lines towards binary stars. So these were singly ionized calcium. These lines were seen. Now, what is this interesting about this? That some of these lines moved with stellar motion. That means at different parts of the year, you could see these lines move, which is indicating Doppler shift. That means that these lines are being produced by gases which is related to stars. So they are rotating in some way with the star or moving in some way with the star, which is showing this the change with their velocity. But some remain static. That means those which are static has nothing to do probably with the stellar motion, but that is part between the star and us. So that is basically causing absorption between the star and our observer. Now the generic importance and proof came from work by Traplar in 1930. So you are seeing that this interstellar medium, whether it exists and how to deal with it, meaning how to observe it, people were working in less than a century back. So this is comparatively more recent than the other part, meaning the visible the side of the galaxy. So what he did, Traplar, was a simple approach, that he lined up the main sequence stars of open clusters. So you observe open clusters and you assume in a statistical sense, that means for a single cluster you can't say, but if you have, say, if you are observing 50 to 100 cluster, you can assume that their typical sizes are independent of their location in the galaxy. So if you have 10 clusters, what is the median size? Maybe roughly independent of where they are or how far away from you, because we are not special. That is the first assumption, and that means also it is implies, for example, suppose we are at the center of the galaxy, then it will be a different case because you are in a special position. So you may have a more density, maybe there is a dependence of the cluster size with respect to galaxy, but we are 10 kiloparsec away. So with respect to us, there should be no special, nothing special. So what he did was basically to form B by R, that is their angular sizes whole square, and that you plot with respect to L, that is their total luminosity. You will have many stars you are seeing in a photographic plate. Then you add up their equivalent brightness of all of the stars contributing in that star cluster. And effectively, then you find L total, the total luminosity, divided by 4 pi r square. So that means, as you are going away, that is r is equal to 1 to r is equal to 2, you expect that their luminosity, total luminosity, would have fallen by a factor of 4. Because of a factor of 2 increase. In the same way, because of their distance has gone down, their angular sizes would have gone down by a factor of 2. But their angular sizes square will also go to have gone down by a factor of 4. So both luminosity, total luminosity, and their angular size should have fallen by a factor of 4. So this is a simpler way of looking at it. And now you make a plot, because you can measure their distances by other methods in the galaxy. So and then you plot both of them. So this plot should essentially, as I say, a factor of 4, I gave an example, should form a straight line. So which is a factor of 3 away, 3 unit distance. It should be down by a factor of 9 luminosity, total luminosity. Their angular size square also down by a factor of 9. But you find that more distant open clusters appears to have systematically lower luminosity. So if they are at the factor of 3 more distance, if their luminosity has gone down not by 9, but some more factor in the optical. So this is something peculiar, and this now calls for an explanation. Now what are the possible explanations? One is that the faraway clusters are intrinsically bigger than predicted by the luminosity. Okay, because we are plotting one versus the two. Either this is going down or that is going up. So that means either the angular size is going up or the faraway clusters are bigger, meaning faraway clusters bigger. The other possibility, of course, is the observational selection. That means you are selecting comparatively larger cluster as you are going further and further. Okay, but that is unlikely, because as long as you can
resolve the cluster, that means you have many components in the cluster, you are not really biased by the total luminosity. If you cannot resolve the cluster, this issue will come, because their angular size, which are larger, will contribute to more total luminosity, and you will pick up preferentially that, but that is only applicable, you recall, for objects which are not resolved. For objects which are resolved, it, what matters is the surface brightness. So the surface brightness, as long as they are well resolved, should not really change. So this observational selection is unlikely. The other possibility, as I mentioned, that 1 and 3 are coupled together, that means either faraway clusters are bigger, or the faraway clusters are fainter, one of the two. So these two are again looks like unlikely. Then the fourth possibility, which was the right one, was that the faraway clusters are dimmer due to absorption by intervening material, which we know as dust. So this is mainly the discovery, I would say, in 1930s, that intervening material, that is the dust, which was discovered. And so having said that, I will now go a little bit more about the dust. So the dust is, we know, as responsible for extinction. That means if you have large amount of dust in your line of sight, it will basically absorb stellar emission, and you will find the partial reduction in their intensity. Second thing is reddening of objects, because this extinction, or whatever you call, is caused by scattering of light. And third, which is less known for you, is something called polarization of starlight, which does happen because of dust. And this is in optical, I'm not talking of radio here. The fourth is an observable effect, which is something called reflection nebula. Now, you should know certain things. You might, this will probably be talked about in your class, but not as part of syllabus though in BSc. But this is something which is mentioned maybe in third year, that the scattering of starlight is proportional to nu divided by 4. This is called the Rayleigh scattering. And in astronomy, it is particularly important, because this causes, and it is not just that, the observable effect you will see even in our atmosphere. When the sun is about to set, you see more absorption towards this line of sight, and because of scattering by our air, it is nothing to do with dust as such, but of course dust is there in our environment, that's a different issue. But the main thing is that because the lambda is more, that is nu is short for blue wavelength, that scatters more, and that's why you see the sky is blue. But on the other hand, the sun gets redder, because the lambda is comparatively larger, so that means that you will have less scattering in red, and that's why sun appears redder, particularly when it is close to horizon, because the blue light, which has got higher nu, is more scattered in the course, whereas nu is lower for the red light, so it is scattered less. Okay, now in general, this is particularly prominent, this scattering, because this is visible spectrum we are talking of, and the dust size is of the order of lambda. So that's why the scattering is significant. If the dust size is too much, then it may not really cause scattering. They will just cause like an opaque object, but that is not the case in astronomy. Now, what are the dust particles typically composed of? They are typically known to be, which has been studied through their own, or whatever I would call that, their emission properties from dust. That they typically resemble silicates, but could be made of or have complex molecules, because their various rotational spectrum and so on can be observed in infrared, and many of these have been computed based on their emission, I would say the dust emission spectrum. So that can be used to characterize. Now the main thing is that how it causes polarization is because it has got angular, the meaning size, which is not spherically symmetric. A dust particle is typically not spherically symmetric. How a dust particle forms and how it grows is a matter of still research. There are a lot of work has been done over the last 50 years or so. But what we know basically for sure, that it has got a major axis. That means it has got a minor axis and absorbs more light towards it. So then what happens? It has also dipole moment and orients perpendicular to local magnetic. So if you have magnetic field along this, it is orienting, the major axis is perpendicular to the magnetic field, then what is being caused is that if you have light coming towards you, it can be polarized. Now that polarized emission can, depending on the polarization, how it is oriented, can be preferentially oriented, meaning part of it, for example, the light which is coming, meaning the emitted in this way, which plane, it can preferentially absorb. So one of them is more preferentially absorbed because of the magnetic field, because of the major axis. So the scattering is more when the major axis is, and major axis, if it is along you or perpendicular to you, is not the general case. You take it at 45 degrees.
give it the order of the 30 degree, whatever you want, some intermediate angle. And then the major axis will cause more scattering in that direction, less more absorption, and you will have less absorption in the perpendicular direction. So that is what is thought to cause as the polarization. It gives rise to polarization effect. So it has dipole moment and orient, so the above causes polarization of star effect. So I'm not going much into details. This can be drawn on the board and shown how it happens, but this is not, again, this is more of a general description at the introductory level I'm giving to you without going into any details. So this is just for your the basic understanding. No, it is basically scattering. We are talking of scattering, but the scattering depends on the dust size. So now if they are preferentially oriented in one direction, many of the dust grains, so then they will depend, then they will cause preferential scattering in one direction more and one direction, perpendicular direction less. So then the light which will reach you, depending on the orientation of the light, meaning the dipole vector, meaning the basically, you know, that if light is coming along you, it will have, either it can vibrate, the sinusoidal can be this, or it can be this, like this. So now one of them is the preferentially attenuated, the meaning either vibrating along this or vibrating along this. Right? So this vibration, one of these two is preferentially more scattered. So another is less scattered. So then suppose you have Z axis, you have vibration along X and Y. Suppose that the dust axis is somewhere, is oriented such that vibration along X axis is more scattered. So then X axis scattered light will come, the meaning the light reaching you whose vibration is along X axis will reach you less. Y axis whose vibration is will reach you more. So you have a light which has got more Y axis vibration than X axis.
So why is that? How is it that one particular axis
yeah,
like that is chosen to be like
major axis? Yeah. No, that's a good question. The point is, you in general would expect the dust to be randomly oriented. The preferential orientation of dust is such, I am saying that this is attenuating or scattering more along X axis, is because they are all oriented towards the X axis, assuming that the magnetic field is along Y axis, because they are preferentially oriented perpendicular to the magnetic field. So if there is no magnetic field, yes, they are random. But when there is magnetic field, there is preferential orientation of the dust because it has got dipole moment. What is a dipole moment? Meaning which has got effectively a charge. So it will basically orient accordingly if it has got a dipole moment. Yeah.
But sir, this medium will have a certain characteristic temperature of it.
Yeah.
So if it has a temperature, then there will be some thermal fluctuation. It will have some orienting away from. So then if we look at the polarization, then we'll definitely find some components which are in the other polarization. Then from this, if we can calculate the ratio, can we get an estimate of the temperature of the gas from this?
You can, but I think what happens here, it is not just the temperature, there is also an effect of turbulence. So in a galaxy, typically both are mixed. So in general, from this effect, that is basically polarization of starlight, you can roughly say about the magnetic field direction, which can be estimated. But now, depending on how much is the scattering, meaning how much is the effect, first of all, this effect, that is the magnetic field and so on, how much, what fraction of dust, see there is a preferential orientation, that's all we can say, and some amount of scatter, meaning dust will be there which is not along the magnetic field exactly because of various effects. One is temperature you are saying, but again temperature is less likely to have an effect of dust as compared to gas molecules, because the smaller the mass, the more is the effect. Dust is comparatively larger, meaning in mass compared to the molecule. So I would expect less effect on dust. Because it's basically half mv square goes as nkt. So if you have nkt fixed, m is larger, v is small. So that effect will be much less. Because this is, though dust can have something like micron, 10 to the minus 4 centimeter, which is typical, 10 to the minus 4 to 10 to the minus 5 centimeter. Whereas molecule you are talking about 10 to the minus 7 centimeter, 10 to the minus 8. So they are much, much smaller. So you will have maybe tens of thousands of the molecules forming a dust grain. So, because of that, the effect of the temperature you will not really get from
there. But there will be thermal broadening, right?
There will be thermal broadening. That is always there.
So,
if there's a lot of interstellar medium, how can we say that, like, where the local magnetic fields are interesting?
No, that I agree. These are all tough questions in astronomy. We know that you are integrating over the line of sight. So if the magnetic field direction changes, then yes, it may become difficult. Now, this is where various assumptions come in, that for example, suppose you are looking at a particular arm of the galaxy, then you can say that, okay, most of the matter is probably in that arm. Assume now in that arm, the magnetic field is all having similar direction in that arm, like that. If you have two arms, now you consider, okay, how much they differ, and so on. So you have to model it, basically. These are all model dependent. Okay. So now the point is, let's move on. Now the dust gets heated by absorption of starlight. The typical temperature is around 30 to 50 Kelvin. They re-radiate in infrared like a black body, but they are not ideally a black body. They are more like a gray body because they are not ideal absorber. So now the main component of the far infrared radiation is dust, that we know. And the number density of dust particles is shown to be proportional to gas density. This is rough. I am not saying they are exactly the same, but they are proportional, almost, meaning this like order of magnitude proportionally. That means you can have 10-20%, 30% different, but they are not differing by a factor of few. So that is the way it goes. And the dust emission, in general, as I said, that one of the main component of far IR radiation. So the dust emission in infrared can be used as a tracer for certain other properties of ISM, particularly to predict dust density and absorption in any particular direction of the sky. And as you can see, that one of the application in astronomy of this the absorption is that in a particular direction it provides rough distance estimate for an object emitting. So suppose I look at the galactic center, we know that there is a lot of dust in our towards the galactic center. Now suppose I see a star in that direction, then immediately I can say, okay, this star is closer than the galactic center. If it is further from the galactic center, we will not be able to see. Similarly, that is true in optical. As you go in infrared, where again the nu is the decreasing, lambda is increasing compared to optical, you find that, okay, there will be intermediate situation. That means where the absorption between, say, you are observing a 2 micron, 4 micron, 6 micron, you will see difference in the absorption. And you find that depending 2, 4, 6 micron observation, you are being able to see absorption, significant absorption, but the absorption is not as high as the in galactic center. Meaning, if you know some source at the galactic center, close to galactic center, you have a distance estimate already. So you can now say, okay, this is like 26 magnitude absorption in visible. Now you put it into infrared, corresponding absorption you find. If this is less or more, you can now have a rough estimate. If you assume that the leaving aside the galactic center component, the rest of the dust in the galaxy, what you see, the number density integrated is roughly proportional to distance. Now you can roughly estimate the distance of the object. So, but these are not again problem often possible in radio. Optical. But you can do some of this in infrared because depending on how much absorption you see, and even in X-ray, this can be done. This approach. Okay. So this is all about dust. Now let's go to a optical nebula. So the optical nebula have different categories, like the dark nebula, which is just because of dust absorption. Then you have reflection nebula, that is bluer than the direct light. Then you have nebula, which is called H2 region or photoionic hydrogen gas. You have fourth, planetary nebula, and supernova remnants. So these are the typical nebula. Nebula means you see the blob of emission or blob of absorption in the sky. So dark nebula is nothing but the obscuration of background stars. Reflection nebula is caused by scattered light from embedded stars. So embedded stars are shining on the thing and you find blue reflection, very similar to what you see in our environment, atmosphere, that blue light. So you find more blue light in that direction from that emission as compared to what you are seeing at the stars. You know that you are seeing scattered light from this thing. Then the photoionized region, that is H2 region, is caused by hot stars, O and B type. The photoionizes the surrounding gas by its high UV radiation, ultraviolet radiation, forming H2 regions. H2 region is nothing but an astronomer's notation of ionized hydrogen, nothing else. So their spectrum is dominated, optical spectrum is dominated by emission lights. And these H2 regions also have radio continuum emission. In fact, this is more of an information I give typically to the people who are coming for PhD for the first time, meaning not undergone any coursework. We say that, okay, you don't expect to see stars in radio, but H2 region can be seen.
and why you cannot see stars in radio is just because of Rayleigh-Jeans law. You may not have come across this again from the black body. You can define the Rayleigh-Jeans when the lambda is large, comparatively large, which is given by the 2kT by lambda square k is again Boltzmann constant, T is temperature, lambda is wavelength times delta omega. Now, given the typical T, which is about 10 to the 4 Kelvin for a star, you divide by lambda square multiplied by delta omega, which is very, very small, you will find that the emission, given the black body, the emission will be very, very low at radio. So you don't see that. But H2 region, despite having similar temperature, you can see because it's not a like a point source of, I would say, maybe a star size is how much, like 10 to the 4 kilometer, 10 to 5 kilometer kind of. So more like 10 to the 5 to 10 to the 7 kilometer. Whereas this thing, the H2 region can be a parsec size, which is about 10 to the power 18 centimeter. So rather than 10 to the power 10, it becomes 10 to the power 18. So because of that large angular size, you can see pick up in the H2 regions in radio quantum emission. Okay, so this is a very short introduction about the optical nebula. And now we'll carry on about, again, a bit more, that H2 region, how they are created. So typically we see a hot star ionizes roughly spherical region around it because of UV photons. And this is called, the sphere is known as by the name of Strongjian, who analyzed how you the find the radius of such an object by his name called Strongjian sphere. And the size is determined by equating the number of ionizing photons from the central star to total number of recombinations happening per unit time. So here again, the temperature is roughly about 5000 Kelvin of that order. So at the boundary, at R is equal to the boundary, where it determines is basically where at equilibrium, the ionizing photons equals the number of recombinations happening from the same region. So that would determine how far the photons can go. Now H2 regions also emit radio recombination light, which is nothing but Bohr orbital transition. You typically know in optical, you have Paschen, the Palmer series, Lyman series, all these series are there. But that is at n much smaller than whatever, 5 or so. But the n is equal to 5 or less. But here you have n is equal to 252 to 251, like the Bohr orbit. So such transitions also take place, not in lab. You can't do that in lab like H1. But they do take place in the interstellar.
Are these forbidden lines?
These are forbidden lines in our environment,
yeah, right,
where because of pollution, the gas will get de-excited, meaning those the things will get pollution de-excited. So they cannot just wait for a long time to wait. They don't have that long time. So these are basically radio recombination lines, and they are seen in radio wavelength, meaning gigahertz, even hundreds of megahertz. Now, planetary nebula forms when a white dwarf star shines. This I am changing from H2 region to planetary nebula. When a white dwarf star shines light on the dense circumstellar medium ejected earlier by the star during its red giant phase. So a star becomes large near the end stage, which is red giant. And then this thing at the inside, which is the star, finally goes into white dwarf. This we are talking of solar mass stars, below 1.4 solar mass. So, and then these lights, whatever they become, the white dwarf, they are the shining, meaning they remain as a good emitter for a long time to come. And the surrounding material which is ejected in the red giant, they are they become visible by that light, and this is known as planetary nebula. You will have a central star and you have a blob of emission around it, particularly the sphere you will see in optical. Finally, in the optical nebula is supernova remnants. So these are the remnants of supernova explosion and stars of mass greater than 10 solar mass. This is one way, which is called the type 2 supernova explosion, where at the end of their life, livers in supernova explosion releasing about 10 to the 51 hours of energy. This is of that order. It initially drives a shock to the surrounding matter ejected by the star in its life, and it can expand with a speed of the order of 10,000 km per second. Okay. During expansion, supersonic, it sweeps up matter, forming a shell. So that is the way it goes on expanding, and it can go on expanding for 10,000 years or so before it gets dissipated, fully dispersing to the interstellar medium. So as the matter ejected becomes less compared to the swept up ISM, it starts to slow down, free to adiabatic expansion. Initially, it is expanding freely almost because it is not being decelerated because of interaction with the interstellar medium.
But as the matter ejected becomes, actually this is not less, as the matter ejected becomes more compared, ejected matter becomes less compared to the swept up matter, then it goes slowed down, because the kinetic energy is transferred not just to the component of the star which came out, but also to the surrounding material. So it's basically half mv square goes into half m prime v square, where m prime is much, much greater than m because of the circumstellar medium. So that, then it will get decelerated, and that goes into something called adiabatic expansion, and then it later on goes into different stage altogether. So the shock around the expansion front causes diffusive shock acceleration to the electrons, causing them to reach velocity of the order of c. Okay. This is, so I'm just talking about supernova in a minute. At some point in life, so this is basically the supernova is expanded to something called the angular scale, or meaning linear scale of the order of r. This is basically the front shock, this is the back shock. And this is the region where there is shock. Shock means what? You have basically pressure inside. Pressure inside is higher than the pressure outside. So this pressure difference will cause basically shock front to form. But the general definition of shock is that when something is propagating beyond the sound velocity. So that causes the shock, because it has no way to tell other parts of the medium what is happening. So that is called a shock. And this shock, what causes it, what happens is that high energy electrons, whose velocity is much, much less than c, but it is of the order of c. So maybe c by 10, let's say to start with, let's say c by 10. When it crosses this kind of shock front, there is some mechanism which basically causes them to accelerate back and forth, and this re-energizes the electrons to high energies, velocity close to c. And they emit synchrotron emission. This is seen in radio. Synchrotron is more closer to cyclotron emission. You would in BSA 3rd year probably have already heard of cyclotron emission. When velocity becomes close to c, it goes to synchrotron. Now what happens and so on, we are not going to any of the math and so on here. I'm just saying that they emit synchrotron emission, which is visible in radio from this region, because there is meaning re-acceleration. So then, some of the supernova remnants which are there are like crab, which is 1000 years old, Cassiopeia, 400 years old, are some of the very well-known supernovas, not just historically, but they are also based study in Now let's go to the multi-component ISM, because this all I described till now was ISM, part of ISM, which are easily visible, meaning comparatively more easily visible, because supernova dependent H2 region, planetary nebula by its own emission, whereas absorption by the dark nebula. So these are the kind of absorption emission you see. But now we come back to situations or the more generic phase of the interstellar medium, which are not in general visible, meaning if you observe with optical telescope though, but they are having multiple components, and broadly these are divided into ionized and neutral components. So these are the two types of gas you will find in between stars. One is ionized, that means it has gone into plasma, electron and proton have come out. The other is, they are neutral, that is electron and proton are all together. Now the ionized gas has two parts, what is called as hot ionized medium and the warm ionized medium. Hot means what? Its temperature is around 1,000,000 Kelvin. And that again, how it comes? The supernova shock re-accelerates electron, as I said. So this, that 10 to the power 51 arg of energy, which has been dumped by each of the supernova explosion happening in a galaxy, they causes this. And if you have many supernovas, they can form chimneys and channels like that. They are many. There is not immediately. Suppose one supernova happens at time t is equal to t, another happens t plus 20,000 years. This has not fully dispersed. It is partially dispersed, 10,000 years old. So if you have another one, after 10,000 years, that also comes here. They will form, like if you have another shell, you will have this part which is common. So they will essentially blow out. This is the kind of ways it will get formed, a part of chimneys and various tracks. And so this, how you knew, is because of discovery of diffuse X-rays from interstellar medium, indicated for the first time that there are component temperature around 1,000,000 Kelvin. Because if you have thermal, you can easily compute from the black body emission formula, where you know that something, okay, again, you would not have probably read, some of you would have read already, I think, in second year, something called Wien's law.
which means that you have lambda max at 0.29 by t. And if you have considered X-ray, which is at angstrom wavelength, you can easily compute at your home. I'm not going to do it now. As a just an order of magnitude at angstrom wavelength, what is the t you need? You find that the t required is very, very high, 10 to the power 6. So if you have 10 to the power 6, you get for 0.3 divided into 10 to the minus 6, so 10 to the 10 to the minus 7, you can see it's coming into the closed phase. So you need 10 to the power 6 to 10 to the power 7 Kelvin gas to produce X-ray. And how they come was the mystery, but people then realized that the most energetic phenomenon in galaxy is not by stars, but by supernova explosion. And they are the one accelerating the, meaning they are generating this. Okay, so that was hot ionized medium, but warm ionized medium is more common, which is strong jet sphere I already mentioned. That is basically H2 regions forms in the galaxy by stellar emission. So that will basically be forming the warm ionized medium. And then you have the neutral medium. The neutral medium is basically again very common in our galaxy. You can have neutral medium, not just the H1 atomic hydrogen, you have also molecular gas. So this molecular gas has multiple components, molecular cloud and atomic hydrogen. This 21 centimeter emission from atomic hydrogen was predicted after Second World War by Van der Waals and later detected by actually not two groups, I would say three groups, I will come to that later. So what we know that roughly about half of all atomic hydrogen is in one neutral medium with temperature of the order of 4000 Kelvin. The low volume density, it has got low volume density, that is about one particle per cc is the typical number density. If you consider with gas in this room, you know that 22.4 liter of gas has got 10 to the power 23 molecules, right? So that means per cc, if you go down, it is like 10 to the power 19 molecules per cc. Whereas we are talking of interstellar media, you can see immediately one particle per cc. So you have a density almost like 10 to the power 18 times lower than what we see in our Earth's environment. So that is the kind of low density. You know that if we are taken out interstellar medium without oxygen mask, we are dead within a few minutes because you can't breathe anything from there. So, but it is there. So you can be surprised that's why astronomers bothered at all about it. Is if it is 10 to the power 18 times lower, they consider it as blank vacuum matterance. But that's not the way. The main reason being that its effect are seen because you are also seeing objects passing through several parsecs, which is like 10 to the power 18, 10 to the power 19, 10 to the power 20 centimeters. So they add some. So because of that, their effect is important. Now, what is their scale height? So that means you have a galaxy, which for simplicity, we normally consider a galaxy as a disk, but of course you will have spiral arms, where the density is more. You will have spiral arms. But what is this thickness? It depends for the various components, like the one ionized medium, WIM, can be of the order of, for our galaxy, can go to about 1 kiloparsec. Whereas the molecular gas, or the H1, is smaller. I would say of the order of 200 parsec. Okay. So ionized medium can go higher, whereas the H1 can go 200 parsec, whereas the molecular cloud, more denser, can go of the order of 50 to 100 parsec. So depending on the object density. Okay. Now I come to hot ion. Okay. So I mentioned already about warm neutral medium at around 4000-5000 Kelvin. I also mentioned about the cold neutral medium, which is distributed in relatively dense clouds. Their temperature is around 100 Kelvin. You can get bored saying that, okay, these are all description. But yes, description is also important in astronomy because many of these doing it mathematically would take multiple classes to go in. Each of these has to be dealt with separately, which will make you a 20 lecture class just for the interstellar medium. Actually, we need to get a basic view of it. This is more like the basic view which you will find. So anyway, in simple models, these four components, that is the hot ionized medium, warm ionized medium, warm neutral medium, cold neutral medium, these are the four basic components of the interstellar medium, the interstellar gas, I would say, exist in stable equilibrium, but this is following old simple model. This is not necessarily true now. There are some changes which I will come much later. So now how would they call for equilibrium? They are in pressure equilibrium. That's why one cannot squeeze into the other, otherwise they won't stay in equilibrium. So what you can tell from here, NKT,
for each components are about the same. Okay, so that means for some components like hot ionized gas, which is about 10 to the power 6, its N has to be much, much lower. So for example, the gas at 10 to the power 4 Kelvin, 10 to the power 3 Kelvin versus 10 to the power 6, the number density will go down by a factor of 1000. So that NKT has to be, so N into T is basically a constant, roughly a constant. So the equilibrium temperature for each of the components are set by near equilibrity of heating and cooling rate. So you can ask why are different components at different temperature, because it all depends on their heating and cooling rate. So what is the cooling occurs by various atomic processes in the interstellar medium. For example, positional excitation of fine structure transition of heavy atoms or ions, like one is the 157.7 micrometer line. This is in will come in infrared, because you can see the long wavelength. 157 micrometer. So, and this comes from ionized carbon, C2. So this is one of the main the line which basically the comes from the interstellar medium, and it cools the medium because energy is coming out from the interstellar medium. There are various such issues, but this is one line which is very important to get the energy out of the interstellar medium. Okay. Then the multi-component ISM, I am also mentioning few other sources of heating. Cooling was one such. The heating occurs by starlight. Then you have energetic ionizing particles. And C, shocks and waves. So all these three are important. Yeah, so high Mach number shocks, you can show that T2 by T1 goes as by 5 by 16 times M square. M is nothing but a Mach number or their pressure ratio. And that is basically subscript 1 is for ambient. So that is all. So SNRs can form filamentary structures, and multiple SNRs can join to form chimneys driving galactic outflow. So SNR is basically supernova remnants. Okay. So this is some basic idea about multi-component ISM. I would little bit mention I already about magnetic field, that this could be generating, origin of magnetic field is still not 100% clear to us. So it could be generated from primordial field, that means fields which generated at the time of the Big Bang, which we think is unlikely. This is probably an unlikely model. More likely model is basically it got amplified due to differential rotation of galaxies forming dynamos. So the dynamos are probably the creator and maintainer of the magnetic field. But there was a seed field required. That seed field might have come from primordial magnetic field, primordial field. So the typical strength in our galaxies of the order of 10 micrometers, and you can measure for line of sight either through Faraday rotation or Gibbon splitting. And the sky plane components come from synchrotron agents. So synchrotron is in radio. Gibbon splitting typically would occur in radio also. It can also, meaning that is OH measures is one the such thing. Measure you might have heard of, which is equivalent of laser in radio wave. So there you can fly Gibbon splitting. Faraday rotation is also being seen in radio. It can be also seen in optical. Some colleges have it in second and third year experiment also.
So,
yeah.
So, what is the primordial field in the last slide?
Yeah, primordial is basically it is the field which was generated just after Big Bang. So, something was there at the beginning of the universe. We assume that you don't know what caused it and how it caused. So, whatever caused the Big Bang, from that something got generated. So, that's the possibility of the same field. Yeah. So, now I come back to atomic hydrogen again, slightly more details from multi-component ISM back. Many multi-component ISM back to. Neutral hydrogen. So the main observed constituent of the ISM is atomic hydrogen. It's got a frequency of 1420.406 megahertz. The transition, Harshati Esther already mentioned, the transition probability from the hyperfine transition from level 2 to 1 is pretty low, is about 2.8 × 10⁻¹⁵ per second. And it was first observed in 1951 by the earlier I mentioned Van der Woolst in 1945 predicted it. But it was detected by three groups almost simultaneously, and they published together. That was a good thing. Ewan and Purcell in Harvard, Muller and Oort in Netherlands, and by Pauzy in Australia in 1951. So all three groups published together. The initial work was to characterize the large-scale H1 distribution in galaxy, which I could see already some of you are interested also. But this work was done in 1950s, 1960s, and so on. That how you find out the large-scale distribution of H1 in the galaxy, which will tell you, given the type of galaxy we think for ourselves as compared to Andromeda. So you would expect many arms and so on, how is the structure you can derive of our galaxy from observation of neutral hydrogen. So later the emphasis shifted from the large scale structure to the smaller scale nature of the H1,
and more importantly, the physical properties of each one. That is, what is this temperature, how the temperature varies from the parts, one part of the galaxy to the other, how is various characteristics, meaning how it works inside, how the physics is working inside each one. So to find it out more. So those things or the many work has been done. And how it relates to other components of the ISM. So I would show you one such slide. This is taken from Arshaur Kellerman book, Galactic and Extragalactic Radio Astronomy. In this book, you should find in the library. Otherwise, even a PDF file of this chapter I may be having with me. If you want, I can send you by email. But whatever, one chapter I can perhaps say. But you will also get this book, because this part, that particular chapter, H1 distribution in the galaxy, I would suggest those who are more interested in details should go and read from that chapter. Okay. So this is the typical, I have rotated it just to show you slightly better way. This is the brightness temperature, which is shown in contour and in grayscale. And this is L. So in the first one, L goes from 190 degree here to a zero, and it goes to minus 10. So this is the galactic center region. So you can see the spread in velocity goes from minus 250 to almost like plus 250. So this is the velocity spread of H1 in our galaxy. So if you are making an instrument to observe galactic H1, you should consider a line width of the order 500 km to be easily accommodated. Okay. And this goes to you from plus 10, 0, goes all the way up to 170, so other half of the galaxy. So you can see there is systematic variation of the brightness, temperature and the velocity. As you move along the galaxy, the spread is happening because these are contour maps, so you have multiple components along different line of sight. And this, you can see that how it changes close to galactic center. So what is detected in the measurement, I would go into a little bit of that. What you will plot is something called its spectrum, that means I as a function of nu. And this side is mean. So that is what you are typically plotting, and this will give you whatever curve you expect. So something like that, suppose you can get in some direction. You can get, meaning I just draw the schematic diagram. Is a line profile, intensity is a function of frequency. The frequency indicates the Doppler shift from the center. So suppose this is mu naught, you know this as mu naught, which is basically 1420.4 megahertz, at other points, that is here or here, is determined by Doppler shift. And given the H1 the line velocity, you can show that by Doppler shift, 1 kilometer per second corresponds to minus 4.74 kilohertz. So if you have 10 kilometers, you will typically find the 40.7 kilohertz shift. So that is the kind of velocities. If you have 100 kilometers, you will get 400 kilohertz shift, 0.4 kilometer shift. So velocities are typically measured in our galaxy with respect to local standard of rest. How it is defined, again, you will get in that book. You will get in other places also. Because this is a particular, because sun also has around sun, you have peculiar motions. So those motions has to be taken out. You expect the local standard of rest, meaning as if sun is at around sun, there is still some uncertainty about the velocities that you take out. So with respect to that, so this is inside our galaxy, you could use the local standard of rest to define the velocities of them. Now, what you see is the typically get the galactic kinematics, which influence the observation. The natural width of H1, I would mention, is 10 to the minus 16 kilometers per second, which is very, very small. Now, compared to what we see, which is typically few kilometers per second. So it's like 10 to the 16 kilometers, 16 times larger, compared to intrinsic line width, which is determined by quantum processes. So that comes from quantum mechanics, that how we wide a line. So that depends on the line again. So the broadening of H1 line happens by thermal motion. So suppose you are observing a gas cloud in a particular direction, its temperature is T. The question is the line emitted towards you, H1, will it be the H1 line? Will it be monochromatic, that means at a particular frequency, or will there be spread? Yes, there will be spread because of two reasons. One is that some gas the particles are coming towards you, some particles going away from you. So that will cause a line spread, and you can say that broadening of line by thermal motion is around 0.09 root T kilometer per second. So that means if you have 100 Kelvin temperature, you will have 0.9 kilometer line velocity. If you have 10,000, you will have
almost like the 9 kilometers length. So typically we'll find in emission, the line width is of the order of 10 kilometers. That tells you, okay, it has got high temperature already. But of course it has contribution from turbulence also. So that's why we observe many different directions, find out the smallest line width in emission. That will tell you roughly what is intrinsic. And this turbulence can go up to 5 kilometers per second in our galaxy. So that also confuses the matter. Now in general, the galactic rotation can broaden the line due to superposition of components along the line of sight. Okay. Now having said all this, I will essentially go into few more things. It can be done, I guess some of you would have done it probably in your physics second or third year as part of whatever thermodynamics and so on. That, but this comes from radiative transfer really, that you can show that if kinetic temperature is Tk, the brightness temperature is Tb and optical depth is tau, they are related by Tb is equal to Tk into 1 minus e to the power minus tau. Have you already heard of it, many of you, or some of you don't? Now I will not go into derivation, but the basic thing is, again, I should check a book and give you reference, just find it out from there. I believe if you check many of the basic astronomy group, not popular astronomy or amateur astronomy, should also have it in their radiative transfer. The book which I mentioned, the Galactic and External Radio Astronomy, they would have also derived it. But this essentially comes from the kinetic, meaning the is not difficult, something which can be done on book.
Kinetic
temperature is basically which is determined by your motion of molecules or atoms. That is kinetic temperature. So it's a governed by motion. Brightness temperature is nothing but the temperature which you will derive from brightness, that is the Planckian, and the meaning of black body emission. Okay. So these two are related by something called optical depth. So how you derive there is basically you have to have a number called absorption coefficient K nu times ds. So a medium is emitting and absorbing together. So you consider J nu as the emission coefficient, K nu as the absorption coefficient. So you'll have integrating over J nu and times K nu times the attenuation, that you integrate, you do that, and then you add relate K nu with basically what you know from blackboard. So that you do that. So this is done typically. And what you can show for your experiment, I mentioned that atomic hydrogen, what you get the number density, or column density, this is called, known as typically as column density, is given by 1.8. 8 to 10 to the power 8 is nothing but a constant, times Tb, which is the brightness temperature, times dV. Actually, this is not dV. Okay, this is the velocity with per cm square. So this is what you will typically use from your experiment, whatever the column density, if you want to determine by the line, because this Tb, dV is what you are seeing here. This is I nu, or equivalent Tb of line. So you see a line like that, you can integrate over the line and find out what is the column density using that relationship.
Where is the constant? How is the constant value?
Yeah, that is coming from the what is the single atom, how much it contributes. So because of that the thing comes.
Okay. It follows the Maxwell distribution.
Yeah. Safely Maxwellian distribution. Now I'll go a little bit, and that is basically, again, this is in that book, but I would just refer you to this picture. This is particularly important. There are more things in that book for details for the differential rotation of our galaxy. But the basic thing all of you should know, that why the velocity differs at different parts of the galaxy. And this is determined by trigonometry. So you have the galactic center here. You have sun there. So at the position of sun, it's basically weird. The sun is being shown here. And the sun is rotating around the center. So right now we are joining it by a sphere. And we know that sun velocity is now perpendicular. And the rotational omega, that is basically the rotation frequency, is omega naught at the distance of sun. And we know that this omega, that is the angular rotation velocity, is not constant in the galaxy. It varies as a function of r. So that's why at a generic distance r, its velocity is omega r, whereas it is omega naught r naught. Now at any line of sight, at the angular galactic longitude of L, you point, so you are looking from sun towards this direction. What is the component you will see? So you will have a component which is here, which is governed by omega r, and the velocity which is contributing towards u is given by component of omega r along line of sight, minus component of omega naught r naught along our line of sight, because you are also moving. So you have a component along this direction, you take it out, that is the velocity difference which you will see, the line velocity with respect to the observer. So you can show this trigonometry, you can do it, it is not difficult, you can just try it out. I can do that in board, but may not be not in 5 minutes, it will take longer time. So omega cos 90 minus L, L is here, theta is here. So these two, once you know, you can find out at an angular, meaning for a gas at a distance of R, what would be the thing. So you can effectively show that R is R sine L can be given by R, which is the galactic center distance R. R sine theta and R cos theta is this equation. You can show finally V is given by R naught, that is the galactic center to sun distance, times omega R, that is the angular velocity at here, minus omega naught, which is here, sine L. So what you can see that in general, if you consider omega R minus omega naught a constant, or roughly a number which does not, which is not very much different, what you expect if you change L, that the velocity will change a sine. So this is one thing which you will see in your experiment also. If you observe at a galactic longitude of say 30 degree versus 60 degree versus minus 30 degree, you should see a sine change. Okay, that sine change will happen, but of course there can be situations when you are observing this direction, that is you are observing in a direction where R is less than R naught. You have to ensure. So you observe a source here, you observe a source here. Once the L changes sign, you should see a sign change in the velocity. But if you are at that side of the sun, that is you are observing outer galaxy, that may not be true. Because omega R minus omega naught will also change sign. Because omega is a continuous function and it changes as a function of distance from the galactic center. Okay. So these are further characterized by something called Oort constant, which is again derived in that book and so on, called Oort A and B coefficient. I'm not going into, those are more of a details. I'm not wanting to go. This you should understand how it comes. So I'm just showing one slide, but I can mail you if you want this, but you should read this part. That's how it came. That's all I'm asking in your room, which is not difficult for you to do, I'm sure. Okay. So now having said all this, I should finish off in another 5 minutes or so, even when I started. So the main thing is that, now this I will go a little bit about what is GMRT observations, that is the giant meteoroid telescope observation of multi-component H1. And this particular thing, why am I talking in the next slide, is because this observation was carried out for you people in 2012. So we carried it out, but afterwards we are not carrying it out, the data is there. I will show you when I go to GMRT. That is a very simple illustration of what you can show to study warm and cold phases of the neutral hydrogen through H1 absorption and emission. Okay, so this is the plot. What you see is that this is the calibrated source or a compact source in a particular direction of the sky, known as its RA day, 18 hour 22 minutes RA, and day is minus 9.6 degrees. So you see, this is raw data meaning the data from all the 30 antennas collapse, the emission spectrum, which is similar to what you will get from the 4-meter antenna also, except the difference will be that the baseline may not be that good, the signal-to-noise ratio won't be that good. But this is also, remember, this is essentially uncalibrated data. It has not been calibrated for anything. And what you see that the line is roughly constant, but the emission starts from somewhere around 1419.7 MHz in this direction and ends at around 1420.7. So 1419.7 to 1420.7, about a megahertz point line, or the meaning about the 1 megahertz region of the sky, you are seeing emission. Okay? So now this is quite broad line. You have 1, 2, 3, 4, maybe 4, 5, 6, at least 6 components in that. But in the same region, now you can observe the same background source. Remember, this is a background quasar or whatever source it is, whose effective brightness temperature is very high. It can be of the order of a 10 to the power 9 Kelvin or so, or 10 to the power 10 Kelvin, the asynchrotron emission. And if you observe in high resolution, this is low resolution, that means using the full dish as you do. But in interferometry mode, how it does, I am not going to tell you. But basically, it resolves out anything which is common between the antennas, exactly the same. So any total power which you are seeing has been taken out, it will only go into something called cross correlation. That means small scale structure will come. Okay, so those small scale structure, if you look at small scale, not in frequency but in spatial scale. So that means large angular emission will get resolved out would not be seen by an interferometer. But small scale structure in the sky you can see, and that spectrum you see here, which is again starting from around 1419.7 going up to about 1420.7 around the megahertz. But you see they are much, much narrower. So this is like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 components. Here I counted 7 and they are much wider. This is around 10 components and they are much narrower. So this itself is telling you that the gas responsible for emission has a larger line. So you know its temperature is higher as compared to, because it goes as root T, proportional to root T. Whereas this is much colder, in the, which is contributing. So if it was the same gas, you would have seen the same thing inverted, which is not the case. Okay. So this is basically the absorption depth, which is basically you are taking out I nu minus I nu 0. That means what is observed here, far away from the line. You have taken it out. Divided by I nu. So what I am plotting is I nu minus I nu 0 divided by I nu. So this is of course this is not divided. This is just I nu minus I nu 0. No division has been done. No normalization has been done. So that's why we were seeing the unit as Jansky minus 5 Jansky. So that is what has been seen. So that is the absorption spectrum. So this already told you, without going into much of the details, where an observational proof that their temperature are indeed different. And if you consider as root T, you can see that already the line width would be differing by a factor of 3 or so, or the, by I just I can tell you. So the it is a, at least a factor of 10 difference in temperature. So that comes up straight because it is root T. So having said that, I will go a little bit more. This is not our observation or the not for the general observation. This is slightly more advanced one, which also are being done with GMRT. So this is called the multiphase neutral ISM, but the main thing is here what they are, the authors, which is Nilpom Roy and so on, they have tried to show that actually a good fraction of atomic hydrogen are not just in neutral, no, sorry, both are neutral, but not just in warm and cold phase. They are also in intermediate phase, which is unstable phase. So how they are in, why they are in unstable phase is a different question. Perhaps one supernova comes, disturbs the thing before the gas fully settles down, the next supernova happens. So that is what they are plotting, log T. You can see that the log T around for the cooling, heating less than cooling, which is the cold neutral medium, the temperature is 2.60, around 2.2, so 10 to about 100, 200 Kelvin temperature here, which is stable, stable phase. Again, it is stable phase when it goes to close to 10 to 4, 10 to 3.8 to 10 to 4, which is around 5,000, 6,000 Kelvin. In between, 10 to the power 3 Kelvin, which is unstable phase, but there is good amount of gas in this. How they are coming to this? So they are basically was motivated by the nature of turbulence in diffuse H1, what is the true temperature distribution gas in unstable phase. So their main, I think what I understand is that the infra star formation rate is significantly different, because you know that hydrogen is responsible for forming stars. And there, infra star formation level depends on the model, and that depends significantly on the warm neutral versus cold neutral medium, and also on the unstable medium. So whether there is gas in unstable phase, they look for. And what they did is that they used the H1 observation of high galactic latitude lines of sight to measure spin temperature. Spin temperature is nothing but the spin transition, H1 spin transition. So because of that, the same line of sight broke through H1 emission, single dish, and absorption interferometry. So one neutral medium survey using GMRT and Westerberg they carried out, they detected many white components. So these are the white components you can see here, and this is the narrow component. These are many lines which you are seeing towards small angular size sources. You are seeing through narrow lines and through the large, the wide lines. The wide line may be in emission, but you find also intermediate wide lines, which are indicated, meaning you find out the gas temperature, they comes out to be of the order of 1000 Kelvin or so. So, and this is their distribution. One neutral medium is indicated by blue, cold neutral medium by red. You see that these are the different directions, meaning what sources have been seen in emission and in absorption. So that is what is telling you. But rather than that, what I will show is the result that when they correct for many the observable things, they find that the cold neutral medium, which has basically contributed, is 49%, and the warm neutral medium, which is around 51%, but there is a good fraction which is in the warm neutral medium, this 51%, is actually
they are finding fully from interferometric survey, their temperature is around 51%. And the uncertainty they put at around 7%, here also there is uncertainty 7%. Stable they are quoting effectively as 0. That means when everything is corrected, but they are not finding anything. But this may not be 0, you can see an error bar of 7%. So you can have 10-20% involved as stable phase, warm neutral medium. But a large fraction of warm neutral medium appears to be from the present results by the because as in unstable phase. So it could be easily 30% or more, I would think, given the error bar, even if you consider two-sigma deviation. So it could be going up to that. So with that, I will finish and I will take my question from you.
So can the component, different components be identified?
Yeah, meaning like for example you are seeing here, yes, so these are the each of the components. So these are the line of the local standard of rest velocity. Like this the component is at minus 10 kilometer. This is coming at plus 5 kilometer. And this is the white component over minus 20 to plus 20, plus 10. So yes, meaning towards the particular direction you are finding multiple sources. Now are you saying that can each of the component or each of the absorption component can be identified with a particular clamp in a particular, so you are talking of XYZ location in the galaxy. It's difficult. That is very difficult. How will you see that? Because H1 emission does not have a corresponding emission in optical and so on. This is just a gas which is at few hundred Kelvin or few thousand Kelvin emission. So though it is, you can say that few thousand Kelvin, their optical depth is pretty low. So because of that, you will not be seeing significant emission in optical, meaning on optical.
Sir, once we get the Doppler shift, how do we differentiate between like whether it's due to thermal motion or the cosmonaut shift or just its own some velocity?
Okay, no, that is not difficult because the thing is, I will draw a line here, for example. So you know this is nu naught, where you expect the line. You expect the line here. Now from our galaxy, you expect a line here, you have got something like that. From some other galaxy, you see a line which is coming here. So immediately know that this is my line width, full width half maximum, which is characterized by this thing. And this nu naught is beyond that. So you know that this has got a redshift. So nu naught has come at lower frequency. So it is a redshifted line. So because it is away, going away from us, so it is redshifted.
I mean the redshift is due to which factor, how do we know that?
It's typically cosmological. Now are you saying okay, it can have its own peculiar motion?
Yeah.
That you do. So what people do, that's why, if you are wanting to find out in a particular direction in the sky, you have one such object, one galaxy here, you find some redshift. You find another one, you look for nearby the or part of it, that whether they are coming at similar redshift. If they are coming at similar redshift, you know that this is cosmological expansion then. Whereas if they are coming at a very different velocity, now again it is confusing. If it is part of the same galaxy, it's easier to say that okay, this is part of the same galaxy, they are at same redshift. You can have two galaxies, they are seen at two very different redshifts, you can't distinguish. So in general, what people know by alternative methods, that is basically, you are not just observing galaxies, you are parallelly estimating not just from Doppler shift, you are also determining there, say from some other method like CP variable. That's another method in nearby galaxies. You can both will give you the velocities. And when people have done that, they find that nearby galaxies, that means when the Hubble expansion rate is not very significant, that means say redshift not 1, but redshift 0.1. So you know that 73 kilometer per megaparsec is what is the Hubble constant, right? So now suppose you are talking of something 0.1 megaparsec, 7 kilometers. Know that galaxy also has its own dispersion which can go to 20-30 kilometers. So something like that, you will the people have seen deviations. So you determine the distance because of that Cp variable thing, you can determine the distance, not just the velocity. So you have determined the distance using Cp variable. Parallelly you are determining the velocity. You find the mismatch is like 20-30 kilometers. So that's why that 73 kilometer per second per megaparsec, unless you are several megaparsec away, it is not the meaning, it is difficult to assign only to the cosmological. But once you are say 10 megaparsec away, 100 megaparsec away, the effect is much more. So there the effect of this random motion or the typical motion is insignificant.
100 megaparsec away as in terms of redshift, what is the value?